Today I thought I'll become grandmother for you all. How do you like? And you all will be my grandchildren today. Because I'm going to tell a story to you. The story I'm going to tell is going to depict what Indian culture is. The Indian culture, what depth it has got, and what practicality, how they lived in the just a few hundred years back, what was their life, how they imbibed the ideas and ideals and values, and practically it was made their own, as if so natural that they lived those ideals. Now I am going to take you to 800th century, 9th century. Shankaracharya was born in 788, supposed to be, and 820 he passed away. After that, Advaita supporters, stalwarts who came, Vachaspati Mishra, Madhusudan Saraswati, Vidyaranya, all those were the people who established, made it to become one with the Indian culture again. It was lost for some time, and Shankaracharya revived. And Vachaspati Mishra is the life which I am going to discuss today, because it is highly inspiring and shows clearly the what is realization, and how it affects us, how it affects the society, how a man can live in the ocean of bliss amidst all the natural things. Now Vachaspati Mishra was born in somewhere, Shankaracharya passed away 820, a little here there, like Nivedita and Vivekananda perhaps. They might have seen or just have missed, but his guru was Trilochan. Trilochana was his guru. Vachaspati was born in Mithila. Mithila, one of the important cities of India in those days, Mithila. He was born in Mithila, and from childhood, he has great inclination towards knowing things. Everything, as if inquisitive to know everything. Why, what? And then, as soon as he is slightly growing, usually 6 to 8 years. 5 years it begins to send to Gurukula. They will be initiated with Gayatri Mantra in the house and will be sent to Gurukula. Gurukula, he got a beautiful atmosphere and a guru who has totally, absolutely living the life as exemplified in the scriptures, and was a strong Advaitin supporting Shankaracharya's views. That is Trilochan, his guru. Trilochan might have met Shankaracharya, perhaps, looks like that. Or one of his direct disciples must have initiated him. Vachaspati Mishra's guru, Trilochan. Now, he goes to Gurukula. He'll be just like Arjuna for Dronacharya, one of the pet disciples. Why does he become pet? Some certain disciples, children. Because main thing is absolute humility. They become so humble that anything can be put into them. And second thing is implicit obedience. Once it comes out of the guru's mouth, it is done. will be accomplished. Just it has to come out from the Guru's mouth, it is accomplished. That kind of obedience. Third, a perfect disciplined life. Fourth thing is to live in absolute compatibility with all people. That is, he loves everyone, everyone loves him. These few characteristics make Guru give their all to some people who, because their receptivity is more, they can get and they can give to others. Their nature will be such that they can give to others also. As he grew, his Guru was particular not only giving the informative knowledge, but he was given all that is needed for his life, to sustain life, to get the understandings of everything. And the Guru makes the disciple visualize the actualities of things. Now, Guru was such that he could make him insider of everything. Now, Bhakti Yoga you take, make him insider and experience the... Now, suppose he is born with certain nature, he may not like Bhakti at all, he may not like Jnana at all. Somebody may like Jnana, somebody may not like, somebody may like Yoga, certain things which... But if you can make the disciple an insider, then he can imbibe all things. So, he was a, what they call polymath. Polymath is a word in which a person is acquainted and has the knowledge of many subjects with authority and clarity. So, he was like that. And this quality of his made him later on to write commentaries on everything. On all the six philosophies, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Sankhya, Yoga, Purvamimamsa, Uttaramimamsa, everything he has written. Even on the contradictory things he has written as the insider. So, this one rare quality of his, that he was called Sarvatantra Svatantra, means he has owned every aspect of Hindu ways of living and knowledge. Regarding knowledge, he has entered every field of Hinduism. Very rarely we see. Advaitin will be, try to remain Advaitin without knowing much about the other denominations. He was not like that. We'll see his commentaries various, but now a few alone are remaining. Of that, one is Bhamati. So he was brought up in that style, and Guru was particular that he must not only imbibe, appreciate, know it, be able to give to others, but must have realization also. He was making him do all the necessary spiritual practices simultaneously to reach the highest. He found the whole Hinduism, how it was unfolding as I am teaching you. You'll see how the Hinduism goes on evolving and developing into finally one the most sublime aspect of Hinduism, the Advaita, comes into like a butter from the curd churning. Like that you'll see that whole thing. So Guru was particular that Advaita he must experience, the highest he must experience. And he succeeds in and he will be just like Sri Ramakrishna when he comes out of the Gurukula. He is in ecstatic state. Now, at this stage, before he can leave the Gurukula, the parents can come and take, the Guru will be on the deathbed. Guru is going to die. So he calls his disciple and tells two requests of his. One, he had a daughter. The guru had a daughter, Trilokya. He had a daughter, Trilochana. His name was Trilochana. Trilochana had a daughter. He wanted him to marry his daughter. Marry my daughter and write Bhashya on Shankaracharya's, Tika on Shankaracharya's Bhashya, that is gloss on the commentary. Shankaracharya has written commentaries on that, he wanted him to write gloss. So, with these two requests, he leaves the body. Now his parents come, he is in ecstatic state almost. He tells, my guru has asked me to marry his daughter, I don't know what. His parents accept and take them, get married, and father and their family, guru's family and all, want to do something. What do you want? What do you want? What shall we do for you? He says, no, I don't want anything. He is full. Not like the people telling, I don't want anything in anger. And that means they want everything. Some people say, I don't want anything. Means they have a lot of demands which is not being fulfilled. When they said, I don't want anything, there are a lot of demands. It is not like that. He is purna, paripurna within. What does he need? He is in ocean of bliss. Then his wife was also trained by the same guru. In wisdom, in knowledge, she is equal to her husband. From childhood, like a musician's house. From childhood, the children will go on listening. What her husband might not have known or heard, she has heard from her father from the birth. So, she was equally, and she says, if you like, if you can, I wish we will have a small kutia somewhere, a small hut to live on the bank of a river. The parents are all happy. They will build a fine kutia for them on the bank of river. He is as usual in his ecstatic states moving about. He comes with the wife there to that kutia. He starts living. See the elevated states, he is not able to see his wife as wife at all, a living being at all. Like a robo, bhotara, he is seeing God in that person, Atma Swarupa, he is Atma Jnani. How can he see a body there? He never realizes. She comes, she silently, while sending, the mother says, you have seen the life of your father. You have seen my life. See that. You know his state of living. He is in very high state of spiritual awareness. See that you will never come in to disturb his state at any time. She totally accepts and understands because she is a woman of wisdom and knowledge, devotion and love. She totally dedicates to her husband's welfare, and without disturbing in any way, she is doing all her duties to her husband and participating in everything. Both are unaware of each other. She is living with him, he doesn't know. He is living with her, she also doesn't know. But both are dedicating themselves to certain things. Now morning, getting up, he goes to river for bath. She has kept already the clothes ready there. Just he picks up and goes. Every day that particular place is there, habitually he takes and goes off. He has his bath, comes back, by that time all his things are ready. He is to be in ecstatic state, write certain things. Sometimes he will sit in the on the bank of the river and start writing on the sand. She will go and copy down that what he is writing from behind. And all that, hold it in tal patra. In the palm leaves they used to write. So by the time he comes from Bath, palm trees, palm leaves are ready. Everything is ready. And he starts writing the bhashas on so many things. He has written cartloads of books. He goes on writing. In that ecstatic state he is writing. And she, as soon as the leaves are over, the leaves are there. He continues. Every day, everything. Food time, food is ready. He just goes, finishes his washing and comes back. And see, like a machine, he is eating his food. Food is kept ready. See the dedication. Never coming into his presence, she is there with him every moment, but she is not, he's not aware of her being there. And it goes on, life is going on. So many years pass, and he is not aware, she is also not aware. And as soon as evening, he goes to river to give the argya, do his sandhya vandana and all that. As he comes back, already on his desk there is the lamp. His things are there. He to continue his writing. When he finishes, by the side behind itself, he's lying down mat and everything is ready. Pillow is ready. And he keeps everything there. And every bit is taken care. And there is, for food she has to arrange. Because he doesn't have disciples who can feed. Whatever mother's house, something she will collect, she gets from somewhere else, she gets something from her mother's place. And they have to come and give and go. Certain things she grows there itself by the side of kutia. A cow also she has kept to milk. Everything she is managing silently without any disturbance. He is unaware of where he is, what is he. She takes care. And then the Bhamati Tika, the last, he is aging now. Hairs have become already grey. Wife also. One day, it so happens that he is writing in the evening. It is sunset over. He has finished his sandhya vandana, has come to his room, kutiya, and sitting, he is writing certain things. She is just watching. His food is ready on the other side. He is about to get up and go. But last certain ideas, what is coming in his mind, he wants to put. By that time, suddenly, thunder, lightning and wind, stormy wind starts. Wind just pushes the door open. That is bamboo doors, you see. It's a kutiya, paranakuti. So suddenly the door opens and the lamp puts off. She'll be there. She rushes, puts back the door and then brings another lamp and keeps. Suddenly he sees, who is this? He is suddenly, because of the storm and things, he has seen in that lamp, he sees a old woman with grey hairs bringing and keeping the lamp. Every day she is doing these services. But he has not recognized. His awareness is somewhere. And then he asks, who are you, mother? And she, with tears, falls at his feet and says, years back, some 25, 30 years back, we were married. I am your wife, she says. Then suddenly, because that young girl who came with him to that kutia, now that old woman standing in front, where she has gone, his wife, and where is this old lady standing in front of him? Whole life she has spent there without any recognition, without any demands or expectations, only to serve, serve, serve. And being equally competitive, wisdom, knowledge, how to arrange what he has written. Anything to be added, anything to be subtracted, anything to be adjusted, because he writes in ecstatic states. It is to be properly maintained, managed. Which belongs to which? Suppose now he might be writing on Purva Mimamsa, he might be writing on Yoga. It has to be computed properly. Everything she was doing. With this contribution of both, from dawn to dusk, they were engaged in doing this work together, but without knowledge of each other. And then he immediately seeks her pardon. He says, oh, I remember. My guru had told to get married to you. Yes, we had come here as young couple. I have forgotten. Means decades have passed. See the realization. What is realization? And what is the state that they are going to get? And then to honor her, he keeps that, I cannot give you anything. Now, except offer this to you. He was writing Tika on the Shankaracharya's Bhasha on Brihadaranyaka, I think. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. He gives the title to that as Bhamati. So, that is what we see. What a kind of life it was. How they dedicated. How they lived. And after that, a few disciples start coming. Means, how the intoxicated states, to take care of them at the old age, to take care, to give whatever he has, what he got from his guru, he preserved, he realized, he made it his own, and he handed over it to the next generation and go, he has to prepare. So, this is the life of Vajaspati Mishra.
Mother's Day.
Oh, today is Mother's Day, it seems. International Mother's Day. But I am grandmother today. It is nice. Yes. See, how much a person can sacrifice? How much a whole life to sacrifice with one ideal? This is what is expected of us. Some even to do small sacrifices. How much we think we? How much we worry? How much demands of forcing? But where is the sacrifice? Small sacrifices we are not able to do. Great sacrifices. We have lost that tradition of sacrificing. Little work more, already face becomes red. Eyes become red. Somebody has told something. How much of tolerance, how much of patience? Infinite patience. One day, my husband will recognize me as his wife. That one dedication. And he says, I was in ecstasy. I did not know you were there. You used to do everything for me, but I could not even see you are there. And I, in front of me, you might have walked hundreds of times, doing odd things. But my attention never went to that. It was my state. But you knowingly, consciously, what I have not sacrificed, but you have sacrificed. Your sacrifice, because of your sacrifice, all this has been, I have been able to do and give to the next generation, generations to come. Now Shankaracharya's wealth is standing with all of us only because of these stalwarts who dedicated their life for supporting that. Whole India was flooded with Buddhism. Again too, Shankaracharya lived for few years. Within that, he has to give to how many people he could have influenced. But how vast was India. Four corners, four mutt he establishes. Dashanami, sannyasa is, he starts. 10 types of sadhus he creates. Sagara, Giri, Parvata, all these Puri, varieties of 10, who can stay where? And Tirtha, Vanam, Saraswati, all these are surnames or the sannyasa sampradaya given. Dashanami, 10. 10 places they can occupy. Certain people can live in Pahad only. They find difficult to stay in elsewhere. Somebody, they are fit to stay in Tirtha because it is flowing population. He must be able to influence the people coming and going constantly. So, how Shankaracharya makes all these arrangements, 32nd year, he leaves the body. So, look at the work, they move the world. We get the earth movers now. It can lift 10 trucks of mud one day, earth movers. But these earth movers move the whole earth actually. So, shall we go in a little into our what we have done in the last class?